So I would like to, start with this notion that, this was, once upon a time, it was a fancy idea which was considered that the woman will not lose their hairs even if they are giving chemotherapy. And with this, technological advances, actually, it is a truth today. So that is the, great thing about the story. And I'm really touched about the story and the personal experiences Richard shared about his mom. So, many years ago, the technology which was not really advanced and people were not successful in retaining their hairs, but we are really grateful to all the scientists and community who has developed these technologies, and we are able to assure our patients that in a good number they can preserve their hairs. So in next few minutes we shall be talking about some myths and facts and about our studies which we conducted in Tata Memorial Hospital. Next, please. So as we know that chemotherapy-induced alopecia is not life-threatening. However, it is one of the most visibly distressing adverse effects of chemotherapy. Clinicians often neglect it owing to the fact that it can be completely reversible. And also, they are more focused towards treating the disease. Next, please. So at any time point, around 85% to 90% of hair follicles are in a rapidly dividing phase and are hence prone to damage by chemotherapeutic agents. And essentially, scalp pulling causes scalp vasoconstriction, and it reduces the follicular metabolic rate with resultant diminished cellular drug uptake. This diminished chemotherapy delivery leading to potential increase in scalp metastasis, which was a concern for long period. But again, long-term data has allayed this fear. So the past results were of there were a wide variety of cooling techniques used, and there were basic cryogel caps as well as modern scalp cooling systems. And success rates were widely varied from 0% to 90% if you see all the studies all over. And this could be attributed to multiple cancer types being enrolled, various chemotherapeutic regimens, intrinsic patient and/or hair characteristics, technical reasons like optimal cap fit, which is absolutely important. And we should be talking more about this in later. And use of non-validated outcome measures, which is again a very important fact when we decide about, when we talk about the outcomes. Use of wigs, subjective hair loss assessment additionally. Next, please. So prior to scalp cooling, in the scalp cooling system, the cooling cap is disconnected from the coolant lines and it is attached to the subject's head so as to cover the entire scalp with a cap. Then the cap is connected to a coolant line, and the powering on the system activates essentially the refrigeration unit to decrease the coolant temperature. About the duration, so standardized pre-cooling time of at least 30 minutes, then during entire chemotherapy duration, and a standardized post-cooling time of at least 90 minutes should be ensured when we are offering a scalp cooling to any patient. Next, please. So there are some of the positive randomized trials for scalp cooling, although Richard has already shown. So a meta-analysis as well as other randomized control trials showed that there are positive results with the scalp cooling, and there is also acceptable tolerance. However, the common theme in all the above studies was that taxane was the predominant chemotherapy. Only chemotherapy-induced alopecia was measured, and hair regrowth, which again is a very important, factor, and it's one factor which is towards normalcy, was not really measured before our study. Next, please. So we have conceptualized this study, which was a randomized controlled trial of scalp cooling for the prevention of chemotherapy-induced alopecia in India. Next, please. So essentially, it is an investigator-initiated randomized open-label trial. And consecutive women with non-metastatic breast cancer, so they included early as well as locally advanced breast cancer. Again, in majority of the prior studies, we saw that there are early breast cancer patients which were taken, and those were planned for curative intent chemotherapy. We have taken all the patients who were intended to receive both anthracycline and taxane-based chemotherapy in sequential fashion, because this is the backbone of chemotherapy and most commonly used. The non-eligibility was that if a woman is already having alopecia greater than zero at presentation, a history of any prior chemotherapy or personal history of migraines, cluster or tension headaches, or cold agglutinin disease or cold urticaria and lichen planus or lupus. Next, please. So there was a central randomization, and subjects were stratified by the sequence of chemotherapy, whether they are receiving anthracycline or taxane first, and they subsequently randomized to either of the arm in 2:1 randomization ratio. So as I already explained about the scalp pruning procedure, so standard procedure was followed and duration was also same. Next, please. So one thing to note, that prior to starting of the first cycle, nurse, dedicated nurse used to, you know, allot a proper cap size, because cap fitting is very, very important. And also we also experienced in our trial that gradually as the experience become, you know, richer, the results were also, you know, better. So the optimal cap fitting is a must. So there are three sizes of caps available. So one must use the optimum size of cap for the scalp pruning. So how we assessed our results? Alopecia grading was carried out clinically by visual inspection by a primary investigator, as well as by photographing participant scalps in both the groups, and clinical assessment done at baseline before start of each chemotherapy cycle and at primary and secondary efficacy endpoints. Photographs of first 25 subjects who completed at least one cycle of chemotherapy with scalp cooling were obtained at each alopecia assessment. While for subjects enrolled afterwards, the photographs were taken at baseline, at primary endpoint, and at secondary endpoints. Photographs captured here from the front, back, both sides, and from the above. So there were five views which were taken for these patients to ensure the objectivity. For further validation, the independent observer outside the study, and as well as subject themselves, they also assess their hair fall and hair regrowth. And we have done, the concordance relation from the primary investigator's results. Next, please. So primary endpoint was successful hair preservation, which is assessed clinically as well as by a review of five photographs, and using the CTCA version 4 scale for alopecia, wherein grade 0 was no hair loss, grade 1 is less than 50% hair loss, not requiring a wig, and this is measured after 4 cycles or 12 weeks of chemotherapy. So success was defined as either grade 0 or 1 alopecia, that is less than 50% hair loss, and failure was defined as grade 2 alopecia, that is more than 50% hair loss, requiring the use of a wig or a head cover, and participant withdrawal. So after completion of one cycle of chemotherapy, if a participant is withdrawing, that was also deemed treatment failure. Next, please. So this is a pictorial depiction of the grading. So grade 0, grade 1, and grade 2. Next, please. So our secondary endpoints were hair regrowth rates at 6 and 12 weeks, which was a noble endpoint we included in the study. And this is defined as attainment of grade 0 or 1 alopecia post completion of all the chemotherapy. The other secondary endpoints were device-related adverse events, which were determined by the patient-reported symptoms and by scalp examination and tolerance to scalp cooling, and defined as percentage of patients who could complete all planned chemotherapy cycles during a scalp cooling. Patient-reported adverse events included feeling cold, headache, heaviness, and they were all recorded in the case record forms. Next, please. So we also record the cap device malfunction. None of the standard chemotherapy related adverse events were captured inside this trial, and participant reported scores, breast cancer module for quality of life were also assessed at baseline and primary endpoints. So the other exploratory efficacy secondary endpoints were success in hair preservation, which is assessed by independent observer and by subject, as I told before as well. And also the hair regrowth assessment is further validated by independent observer and the subjects themselves. Next, please. So this is a schema. Essentially, the patients are randomized into two groups, 2:1 randomization, and all the events were recorded. Next. So this is the intention to treat population in the two groups, and we can see from this chart that they are well balanced characters, as far as the menopausal status, their chemotherapy regimen sequence, staging, etc. are concerned. Next, please. So these are the chemotherapy regimen distribution. Again, the two groups were balanced. Next, please. So at the time of analysis, the scalp cooling arm, there is 56.3% hair preservation rate in comparison to the control arm, whereas there is 0% hair preservation. So there's a strikingly different rates. And the effect of drug sequencing was very prominent. And 77% of patients who received taxane first were actually has successful hair preservation at the primary endpoint, that is after the 12 weeks. And those who received anthracycline first, this was around 33%. So there is a statistically significant difference as far as the sequence is concerned. And this is, you know, in concordance with the majority of the studies reported. Next, please. So this is the picture, and you can see in the scalp cooling as in control arm, at the primary endpoint, there is a strikingly different hair preservation rates. Next, please. Hair regrowth rate was also significantly better. So at 6 weeks, so we have measured the hair growth rate at 6 weeks after completion of all chemotherapy. So a primary endpoint was at 12 weeks or after 4 cycles. However, after completion of the second phase of chemotherapy, also once 6 weeks are over, then we measured the hair regrowth rate, and also at 12 weeks. This was 89% versus 12% in 6 weeks, while at 12 weeks, 100% versus 59%. So difference was again statistically significant. Next, please. This is the hair regrowth rate in both the arms. Next, please. So this is the, you know, success rate assumption and concordance rate between the primary investigators as well as independent observer and subject themselves. Next, please. So the concordance rate with PI and independent observers with regard to successful hair preservation was 0.914 at primary endpoint and 0.858 at 6 weeks. The PI and subject concordance rate was also you know, quite significant. And there was compulsion to use head covers or wigs by 46.9% of the patients who received scalp cooling, while 100% among controls. So many of our patients, they do not use wig, but they are compelled to use head covers at least. So this is also one of the important findings we noticed, that how many patients they could be, you know, they're not feeling that they are really compelled to use something to cover their hair bareheaded. Next, please. So this is the same depiction. Next, please. About the quality of life, so 1 of 5 quality of life measures were significantly better in the scalp cooling group at the time of primary endpoint as well as at the secondary endpoint. There is loss of hair was reported in scalp cooling arm, 45% at primary endpoint and 21% at secondary endpoint, and while in control arm it is 82% and 53%. Next, please. About the adverse events, so it is pretty well tolerated, and there was a lot of concerns initially when we were beginning this trial, even in our disease management group, our institute review board, etc., that because the climate is entirely different, it is not a cold country, and so how the patients will really tolerate, and we actually put a clause that we will monitor very carefully the 10% of the patients and how they're tolerating, and then only we'll move ahead. So to our assurance that patients really tolerated it very well, and there were no grade 3-4 adverse events. Women have grade 1, that is around 57%, or grade 2, around 12%. Even, and there were majority of the time mild headaches and feeling cold. And in summertime, you know, the other day it was, many women said that it was rather pleasant. So that was one of the interesting observations. Next, please. So the study suggests that the women with breast cancer who received scalp cooling with both anthracycline and taxane chemotherapy were significantly more likely, that is 57% versus 0%, to have successful hair preservation than those who did not receive scalp cooling. And this is consistent with the results from recent studies which show success rate of scalp cooling in 30 to 80% of the patients. Next, please. So other important findings I wish to bring into notice of the house is that these results indicate that scalp cooling is more effective in women who receive taxane followed by anthracycline compared with the reverse sequence. And similar trends have been observed in other studies also. So this is a very important finding, and we must counsel patients very, very well about this point. It was also noted that patients who started on anthracycline first had a high chance of losing hair till the time of primary endpoint, that is around 4 cycles. or maybe at the end of the chemotherapy. However, interestingly, these patients then regrow their hairs during taxane phase. And it was, overwhelming to see that while the chemotherapy is still on, they are on their weekly paclitaxel phase, they started showing baby hairs in the scalp. And majority resumed normal hair density at the end of chemotherapy or within 6 weeks. So thus, this facilitates the resumption of their normal lifestyle. So this I found very interesting and important. And when we counsel our patient, we should say that if you are using taxane first, you will lose your hairs. There are high possibility that you will lose your hairs late. However, if you are even using anthracycline first, there are chances that you will lose your hairs, but you will regrow them fast, and you will towards the end of chemotherapy or within a short period, you will actually will there are higher chances that you will gain your normal density of hairs, and you will go back to your normal life. Next, please. So among the women with non-metastatic breast cancer receiving chemotherapy with the taxane, anthracycline, or both, those who underwent scalp pulling were significantly more likely to have less than 15% hair loss after the fourth chemotherapy cycle compared with those who received no scalp pulling, and this merits wider application. Next, please. So the limitations were that a small sample artifact. Furthermore, the primary endpoint was a successful hair preservation after 4 cycles of chemotherapy, which could be higher than the efficacy at the end of all the cycles. However, notably, we all see in our clinics that majority of the women attained grade 2 alopecia after 1 or 2 cycles of chemotherapy, especially if you are using anthracycline. So this is a well-designed endpoint. And the other randomized trials by Nangia et al., which was the approval trial for FDA, also assessed the alopecia at this time point, which again proves its clinical relevance. So chemotherapy type, sequence, and technicality related with optimal cap fit are potential confounders for real-world outcomes. And again, the training session for nurses is very, very important. And I think this is the bottleneck. And if the cap is not optimally fit, even at certain points, those points patients are losing hairs. So this is one of the very critical point I would like to bring into everybody's notice. And also, there are 3 sizes of caps available, and majority of our patients fit well into a small size cap because of the head size. So that part also should be very well taken care of. Next, please. So the final conclusions. This is the Paxman scalp pulling system was found highly effective in reducing chemotherapy-induced alopecia with a clinically meaningful benefit in these breast cancer patients. And the best effects are with taxane-based chemotherapy, modest with anthracyclines. So if we start with anthracycline, patients should be warned that their hair preservation is expected to be somewhere around 30% to 40% based on the existing literature. However, the regrowth rate is faster and the start during taxane phase. And in many, by the completion, they will retain their normal hair growth. Treatment was safe and very well tolerated, so there are no safety concerns. And the staff training and adequate cap size is critical. Optimum cap fitting is a must. And perhaps way forward is a personalized caps, and about which I'm already in talks with Richard, and I hope you will give me some good news soon. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Jyoti, for the very clear presentation. Any questions?
There was one question which was asked, but I believe Dr. Vora has answered it on the chat function, and that was relating to: would you encourage a patient, or would you continue scalp cooling with a patient even if they've already lost over 50% of their hair? So your view on that would be interesting, Dr. Bajpai.
Right. So as I said, this is a very important question, and yes, because even if the patient they lose more than 50% of hairs during chemotherapy, their regrowth rate would be better. And as we have shown, it was statistically significant difference. So we must encourage them, and we can show them the results also for objectivity that if they continue to cool their scalp in spite of losing more than 50%, there are high chances that they will regrow, the regrowth of hair will be much better. So we should.
Can I ask another question? This is Dr. Mansi. I'm a medical oncologist from HCG. Good evening, Dr. Bajpai. Thank you for the presentation. As routine, now have you switched over to taxane followed by anthra for patients who are receiving cool care? Like, is that the protocol, or how are you doing it? How do you decide in which patients can use taxane and follow the anthra?
So even in the protocol, you know, we have not switched to only those regimens. We were using a majority of the time, we start with taxanes in the patient who are HER2 positive. So taxane along with trastuzumab is our default regimen. So those patients actually receive taxane first. Otherwise, we generally give anthracycline first. So okay. We have not shifted during the trial time also, even the later. As I said that, you know, if we are using taxane first, then the chances are that they are losing, they will lose their hairs later. And if you are using anthracycline first, then they will gain their hairs later, early. So it's a choice between the two. Ultimately, patients are getting benefit irrespective of the sequence.
Okay, thank you.
And also, I believe that...
One of the things, can I also add, Dr. Jyoti, something?
Yeah, please.
Also, Dr. Mansi, one thing what we have to see, weekly paclitaxel, the success rate with scalp cooling is phenomenally high. Like in my practice, almost more than 80% of patients, till the time they are on weekly paclitaxel, don't lose hair. So I counsel them that, okay, 12 weeks are gone with a lot of hair on your head. AC, there is a 40 to 50% success rate chance, like that is what I experienced. 50% of patients who will lose hair, will lose hair only for a limited duration of period, compared to if you use AC first, they lose their hair during the entire duration of chemotherapy, they are going to have Dr. Jyoti was doing a randomized control trial. I do in a real world setting. Patients' perception, even after 70% hair loss, if they have hair here, they still feel very happy and they want to continue scalping. Give them realistic expectations. They actually want to continue. That is what my experience has been.
So very rightly said, Amish, and I completely agree with this, that you know, you have to set a realistic expectation. So some patients have the belief that they will not lose any hair. So one of the patients who has a, you know, phenomenally good result in spite of giving, you know, anthracycline first and later, she was a role model kind of a patient. But then also because she lost 10-12% hairs, and in spite of we have shown her the pictures, the WHO, you know, grading, everything, but because she had in her mind that I should not lose any hairs, that kind of a very young woman, very conscious. So, you know, that kind of expectation you have to, every time I needed to counsel her for half an hour, you are doing great. I'm losing more hair than you without anything. So you know, the realistic expectations and how you are putting in, how you're counseling, and also the patient sitting in front of you is very important.
Okay, thank you.
There was another question in the chat box regarding platelet-rich plasma and new hair growth. Anybody to comment?
Sorry, can you please repeat?
No, platelet-rich plasma, because this dermatology people used to use platelet-rich plasma for hair growth.
So, you know, I'm not the best person to answer this, but what I'm aware, yes, there are some studies and perhaps they are in early phase only. They are trying to, you know, develop this. And I think if anybody is having any clinical data, then at least I'm not sure about it.